Jake Shields. First few seconds might be douchey. I got to make sure he's on the air and good to go right now. But once we get started, we will be interviewing Mr. Jake Shields. So here we go.
All right.
Thank you.
I'm in the chat room.
Dial
that number.
This is what Howard Stern would do when he would call. He would talk over it. Yeah. All right. Thank you. Here we go.
All right. Here we go, guys. Jake Shields. MMAnews.com.
Hopefully everybody can hear me.
Yeah.
And hear him, more importantly. Let us know in the chat if you can't.
Hello?
Hey, Jake. It's Matt. MMAnews.com. Are you good to talk right now, man?
Yeah, I can go right now.
All right. Cool. Appreciate the time, man. We're live on the air. Is that cool?
Yeah, no problem.
All right, buddy. Jake Shields fights this Saturday against the World Series of Fighting welterweight champion Ryan Ford live on NBC Sports Network at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Jumping right into things, like I said, you're fighting for the welterweight championship against Ryan Ford. He's on a 6-fight win streak, 5 stoppages. He's on a tear. Live in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. What are your thoughts on Ford as an opponent, and how do you see the fight going?
He's a tough guy. You know, he's got a lot of knockout power. I think like 20 finishes, so he's dangerous. But he's also someone that, you know, he hasn't fought the same level of competition as me. So I think he's someone I can beat. I just got to, you know, watch the big power. I want to go in there and put him away and make a point, make a statement.
All right. Yeah, but this is your World Series of Fighting debut, if I'm not mistaken. In the first fight since you were released from the UFC. How has your experience been with the guys at World Series of Fighting? You know, the executives and everything like that. And how many fights, if you're allowed to say, have you signed on for with the promotion?
So far, it's been great with the guys. They've been easy to work with. I mean, they're a new promotion, so they're not, you know, not organized the UFC, but obviously they've been around way less long, so they're getting that together, and they've all been great and great to work with. But going to fight for them, you know, that's when you really see how things go. So hopefully the fight goes smooth, and I can give you a better idea after the fight. But so far, I'm happy with them. And I got three to four fights.
All right, cool. The fight's, like I said, in Edmonton, which is, I believe it's Ford's hometown, and you particularly have a history of fighting Canadian heroes or Canadian guys, you know, in Canada. A good example would be your mega fight, UFC's most attended show ever, against George St. Pierre. How do you expect the crowd to react this Saturday, and does being in the so-called enemy territory and being on their home turf, does that play into the psychology of the fight, or once the bell rings, is it a non-issue? Oh.
Yeah, well, I mean, obviously, it's going to be his home territory. I hear he's popular up there, so I'm sure the crowd's going to be strongly against me. But it's, you know, obviously, I'd rather be at the hometown advantage, but it's something that I can deal with. For some reason, I tend to never get at home, you know? I still fight Brazilians down in Brazil, Japanese in Japan, Canadians in Canada, so I'm used to not being on home turf. So it's, ultimately, I just block the crowd out and try to go out there and do my thing.
All right, sounds good. World Series of Fighting, particularly, they've picked up a lot of legitimate talent over the past year or so, especially those in and around, you know, because you jump up and down in weight, in your weight class, in your weight range. Who are some of the guys in the promotion that you would like to see standing across from you in the cage?
Yeah, they have a stacked division in my weight. It's part of the reason for making the choice to go to World Series of Fighting is they want to continue to fight top competition. And, you know, John Fitch, someone I've wanted to fight for a while, Paula Harris, I mean, the whole division's stacked.
You just mentioned John Fitch. I believe you were supposed to debut in July against Fitch, if I'm not mistaken, and then you got an injury and had to pull out. What can you tell us about the injury, how you've recovered, and is Fitch still someone you'd like to fight?
Yeah, you know, it was a minor injury. It was just one of those things. The timing wasn't right. It was the fight was coming up, so I think the fight was like 6-7 weeks away, and I had to call up a couple weeks. It wasn't quite enough time, but right now I'm 100%, so I'm ready to go in there and fight. And yeah, and Fitch is someone I've wanted to fight for years, so that's someone I'm still looking forward to fighting at some point.
In terms of your UFC release, it was a controversial subject for quite a while. You know, you were lumped in with guys who were considered to be similar to yourself, like Yushin Okami, John Fitch, considered to be yourself in the sense of guys that were top 10 ranked fighters that were cut after one loss, but, you know, you had a considerable amount of victories before that, and then, you know, other guys who lose several fights in a row, they get another chance because they're considered, you know, quote-unquote exciting fighters. What are your feelings on your UFC release and how the promotion goes about making their cuts?
Yeah, certainly I don't think it's fair. You know, I just beat 2 top 10 guys in a row before that, you know, being the main event. So obviously I don't think it's fair, but, you know, it is what it is. It's business. They run the show the way they want to run it, so there's nothing you can do about that. I do think, you know, they're trying to push more towards entertainment than making it a legit sport. But that's, you know, it's their show, their decision.
When the UFC did let you go, the UFC president, Dana White, he made the following comment, and I quote, quote, "He's on the downswing, and he's never going to be the guy. His stand-up never improved. He really hasn't shown anything in his last couple of fights," end quote. Does that kind of talk motivate you and almost make you want to go on, like, a tear to prove him wrong? Like, you had had that
Yeah,
sick...
definitely. I would love to go out there and prove him wrong, you know? Especially considering the last two fights before that, I'd just beat two of his top 10 ranked fighters, guys that are, you know, beating everyone else. So it's, you know, people say things like that. But it's, you know, as we've learned, it's the way Dana is. He's always out there trying to... He's always trying to, like, if it's not within the time, he'll try to say bad things about him. As soon as it benefits him to say good things about you, he'll switch it back. He just says whatever, you know. He's really an honest guy. He says whatever he thinks is good at the time.
Is your goal to fight your way back to the UFC, or are you content to continue your career outside of the promotion?
I'm content outside the UFC. I'm not saying I never would fight for the UFC again, but at this point, I'm content being outside the UFC. I just want to go up there and take it one fight at a time and see what happens.
Okay. You were part of the current season that's airing right now of The Ultimate Fighter, which is it's the first time ever there's an all-female cast. It's the first time ever where the winner of the season will become an actual champion of the UFC. What was your experience like as part of Team Melendez and the coaching staff?
It was really cool, you know, going out there, you know, McGill, I've been training with him for, I think, 12 years or so now, so being so close to him, and I got him in the sport.
Yeah.
He asked me to come out and help him coach, so of course I said yeah, and it was fun being there with the team and Nate, and it took a little getting used to training girls first, because mostly only trained guys, but
yeah.
I started getting the hang of it towards the end.
Who are some of the fighters that stand out in your mind? I know you can't obviously disclose anything specific, but, like, as far as your team and the people you worked with specifically, who were some of the people that you were impressed with?
Oh man, all the girls are tough. You know, they're all tough. They all worked hard, and I think if we go and mention specific girls, it'll give stuff away. So I'll just, you know, say overall, everyone on the team was willing to work hard, and we had a bunch of good girls.
Okay. If I'm not mistaken, you were part of the Ultimate Fighter 11 with Chuck Liddell's team. You helped with the grappling coaching. Is that correct?
Yeah.
How is
Yeah, I also helped out the second time doing this.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was going to ask you. How has the show evolved, considering the fact that there's been, you know, what, 9 seasons in between the last time you coached and this time? How has the show changed, evolved? Can you talk a little bit about how, you know, the changes that's happened over the years?
Honestly, it was very similar to the way it was ran. You know, I think because I've already been doing it for a while, so they kind of had it figured out by then. It's, you know, we come in, we have our... We have our 2 sessions a day, you know, the other coach has 2 sessions a day, they keep it steady, and we, you know, we go in, we train the fighters, and then as far as what to do when they're not around us, they kind of, you know, we're only around them 4 hours a day, and people are stuck, obviously the girls or guys are stuck 24 hour days in their house, so it was a very similar format the first time.
Oh, cool. You're currently fighting in the 170-pound welterweight division. As I mentioned, you'll be fighting for the championship this Saturday. Do you have any intentions of moving back to 185 middleweight, or if a fight... or a specific opportunity presents itself, or do you plan to stay at 170?
At this point, I got my weight down pretty light, and I'm happy at 170, but I'm always, you know, like I said, I take it one fight at a time. You never know. If it's the right fight, I might move up, you know. If it's a really big fight, I'd be willing to go up. Right now, I have several guys at 170 that I want to fight, so my mind is set there. But if I was able to, you know, clear out the division at 170, and there's someone I really wanted to fight at 185, I would consider moving up.
Okay. I'm always curious of this kind of thing. When guys are associated, especially like you, you're very associated with a specific fight team. I read that earlier in your career you had worked with Chuck Liddell a little bit as far as training, and now, of course, you're part of the infamous Scrap Pack, you know, led by Cesar Gracie with the Diaz brothers and Gilbert Melendez. How did you become associated with those guys, and how did that team, you know, get formed? Like, how did all that stuff come to be?
Yeah, well, I originally started training with Cesar Gracie, with Chuck Liddell, like, way back in the day, because I was going to school in San Luis Obispo, and that was, I think it was around 99, 2000, so I trained with him for a year or two, and I moved to San Francisco for wrestling scholarship at San Francisco State, and that's when, I'd already known Cesar before back then, because he had some good fighters, like, David Terrell, Gil Castillo, these are old school guys.
Yeah, yeah.
Gil Castillo actually fought for the UFC,
Fought Hughes,
he
yeah.
185 pound belt, yeah, and Terrell, I think Terrell almost, He was in the UFC on a good run for a while, but it was before he got in the UFC. So, you know, I started going to Caesar's gym, and that's when I originally met Nick Diaz. Nick Diaz, I think, was about 18 at the time.
Okay.
And me and Nick were going there. We were the young, we weren't the best guys at the gym, but we were kind of the tougher young guys.
Yeah.
We'd go and just ride it every day. And we were really competitive with each other. We get beat up by guys like David Terrell. We weren't at that level yet, but we kind of push each other. And then, I met Gil and wrestling, college wrestling at San Francisco State. Mm-hmm. So I talked him into going over with me. I'm like, hey, you got to try his jiu-jitsu stuff out. First, I think he was a little reluctant, but I kept on him, and finally I dragged him in there, and then Nick started dragging his little brother Nate in. Basically, go in there, and Nick and or Nate and Gil would try to beat each other up. Me and Nick tried to beat each other up.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we beat up the little brothers. We got like the little brothers, and then kind of just formed a tough clique, you know.
Hell yeah!
And like I said, it was the team was originally, we had a lot of good guys in there with Gil Castillo, David Terrell. It was a really stacked gym. It was a while ago when fighting, you know, there wasn't as many fight teams, and it was a little more hardcore. Back when like the Gracie Challenge was still in effect and whatnot, you know, you get guys coming in wanting to fight someone. And
yeah, at the gym, yeah. Who are some of the guys, you had mentioned a lot of those guys were, you know, back in the day, Gil Castillo, David Terrell, etc., but who are some of the guys that you work with the most these days as far as, you know, your day-to-day training? Who are some of the people that really help you get ready for fights?
Well, now, I mean, I work with Gil, me and Gil are in San Francisco, and Nick and Nate are on Stockton, so it's about an hour, 20 minutes from us. So I see Gil pretty much every day, and then Nick and Nate, it's kind of it kind of varies, you know. Sometimes I see them often, other times I won't see them for a couple weeks, sometimes mm-hmm. I see them twice a week. So for this camp, I did a lot of time with Gil, also with Tara Kazim, who's the guy I've worked with a lot, all my trainers, worked with Johnson on the Wooden Man some, and then, you know, just all the young up-and-comers in Gil's gym. He's got a lot of top young guys coming up there.
Cool. Also, in terms of training, since we're talking about training, I've heard, I don't know if it's true or not, that you're a vegetarian. And I think you've even done like some promotional stuff with PETA in the past. How much does diet and nutrition play into your fight preparation?
Yeah, you know, I am vegetarian. I've been vegetarian my whole life, so it's not something I think about that much. It's just always, it's always what I've done since I've grown up this way. It's so simple, but I think diet is very crucial, especially now that I'm a little older. I pay more attention to it. Before I kind of do whatever, but now I am trying to, you know, make sure I'm getting all the right fruits, vegetables, proteins, and I think it, makes a big difference, you know, especially, you know, extend your career.
Yeah, and with you fighting at 170, I was going to ask, is it as you get older, is it harder to make 170? Is the weight cut an issue, or is it because, like I said, you live a clean life, you eat clean, et cetera, is it make it easy, non-issue, to make 170?
Yeah, I mean, that depends. My weight fluctuates a lot, but for this fight, it's come down pretty easy. I've been trying to eat, as long as I eat really clean and don't blow between fights. That's, you know, a lot of fighters make the mistake of going up like 30 pounds or whatnot. So I try to always keep my weight around 190 or under, so when it's time to drop down, it makes it easy to cut down to 170.
I haven't seen it yet, but I was reading online about a documentary called Fight Life, which you're apparently a big part of. I believe it even won some awards. How was that experience, and what do you think of the finished product, and is it something you would recommend that, like, a true fight fan, they should definitely go see?
Yeah, you know, Fight Life is actually a really good film. You know, I helped out. It was James Fang was mm-hmm. the director, but I helped him out a little bit, helped him make some connections, some ideas, and it was, I thought the film turned out great. You know, it's unfortunate that it hasn't been more wide shown, but it was filmed a while ago. It took place with me fighting Robbie Lawler
in
Strikeforce, and it's, you know, it's full, you know, like Lawler's in the film. It's got, you know, Nate, Nick, Gil Melendez. It follows a lot of fighters. Lyle Bilderdum, Fancy Pants, he's one of the main characters in there, and it's quite an interesting film.
Hell yeah, man! I'm gonna have to try and find that. all right.
I don't think it's on Netflix. It should be, but I think it's really well done.
Hell yeah! Maybe soon. You never know. I'll let you out of here.
Know, hopefully, you get to somewhere. Especially considering a lot of the guys. It was before all of us really, before we really broke through, and then all the guys blew up, which seems like it make it a little easier to sell the film.
You would think, you know, yeah.
Lawler's fighting for a title. Gil's fighting for a title.
Yeah.
Nick's got that big fight, so it's lots of guys in that film ended up going on to do big things.
I was going to say, every name you just named, if you're a fight fan, there's no doubt you would know those names. But, alright, I'm going to let you out of here. I really appreciate the time. But before we let you go, is there a website, a Twitter account, anything you'd like to plug, anything you'd like to say to your fans in closing?
Yeah, you know, Jake Shields, AJ for Twitter, you know, jakeshields.com. And then, of course, thanks to all my fans for all the support over the years.
All right, cool. Everybody check out Jake Shields this Saturday night. He takes on welterweight champion Ryan Ford at World Series of Fighting 14 in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, airing live on the NBC Sports Network at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Jake, thank you very much for the time, man.
All right, man. Thanks for talking.
All right, talk to you later. And there